Let's talk about soil bacteria and other soil microbes. So let's start with you, Cameron. I want to talk about what these creatures are. What are these organisms? What are soil microbes?
Yeah, so you've already mentioned a few of them, bacteria, fungi, fungi, whatever you'd like to call them. But there's a bunch of other microorganisms, and really we're just kind of categorizing them based on size. So these are organisms that are in the soil that we need a microscope to really look at and observe.
So why is it that soil microbes are so important to gardeners and farmers?
Yeah, soil microbes are really at the heart of the major cycles that take place in soil. So when you think about nutrient cycling, you know, we can apply nutrients to our soil, but there are a lot of nutrients that are already in the soil, and microbes are a key part of breaking those down from the other parts that they're connected to and releasing them so that they're available for plants.
So we'll talk to Carrie in just a moment. We're going to get the nitty-gritty on what we're going to find in the soil. But first of all, Cameron, tell me about your Bury Your Briefs work. Why have you been, you know, what is the connection between soil microbes and farmers burying their underpants in the soil?
Yes. Bury Your Briefs, Soil Your Undies, whatever you want to call the campaign. It was actually started by a few Ontario farmers a couple of years ago. And I believe you got some photos that you were planning to share of Blake Vence, who's a very innovative, progressive Ontario farmer who's done this project himself. The idea is that underwear, cotton underwear, is really just made up of cotton fibers. And those fibers, that cellulose, can be broken down by microbes, different types of microbes. And so the goal of the campaign was to get farmers thinking about the activity of the microbes in their soil. How much work are they doing to break down different types of material? Because as we were talking about earlier, microbes break down plant material or dead material and release nutrients from it. So you bury these briefs in the ground, and you come back a couple months later and see how much of that underwear is left.
These creatures in the soil, they don't have teeth. How is it that they are tearing apart underpants and eating the bits?
Part of what you might think about in the way that we digest food is, yeah, we've got our teeth, which crush our food and help break it down. But really, like, there's a lot of enzymes in our saliva. So it's chemicals that we release, which those chemicals are actually what's part of allowing the food to break down in our mouths and in our digestive system and release those nutrients for us. And so microbes do that as well. They release chemicals, types of enzymes, which allow them to access the nutrients and the food that they're interested in.
Let's start off with bacteria. What are they? How are they different from fungi? And how are they helping us in the soil?
Right. Well, bacteria are probably my favorites because even... they're really, really hard to study, but there's like billions of them in every teaspoon of soil. So they're not just really abundant in your soil, but they're really diverse. So we think of bacteria as using sugars, and we think of them one way, but they actually have a lot of different capabilities. So they actually can live without oxygen, they can live with oxygen, and they play a lot of different roles in the soil. So they do a lot of things like transformation of nitrogen and sulfur and phosphorus. And so because of their incredible diversity, they have like a lot of really key roles in the soil. So that's why they're really important.
So I just want to flag what you said. You said there are literally billions of bacteria in one teaspoon of soil.
That's right. Billions. And we don't, they're tricky too, because we can't name them and we can't see them. So we have to use kind of different techniques to be able to study them.
How are fungi different?
Well, fungi are really important in the soil. They're different. There's not as many of them in the soil as bacteria, but actually because they have hyphae, so we picture them, you know, mushrooms are fungi, so they grow with this hyphal network. They actually cover a huge amount of soil. So there's actually more biomass of fungi than there are bacteria, just because they're bigger. And you know, one of the key differences is that they are aerobic, so they need oxygen all the time. So that's when you say you're aerating the soil. Fungi need to have oxygen to grow, whereas some bacteria don't, and that's kind of a big difference. And they're often growing on organic material, so they're feeding off that organic matter. So those are some of the big differences.
And yet they still do a similar type of good work. They're helping to process nutrients, and again, living symbiotically. So helping our plants and trees while the trees and plants help them. It's kind of a partnership.
They have some really cool relationships with plants that we sometimes hear about. So arbuscular mycorrhizal fungi, which are AMFs, we sometimes hear about mycorrhizae. And they have a really unique relationship with many plants where they're have a symbiotic relationship. So they get carbon from the plants and they supply the plants with nutrients and access to water, phosphorus usually. And so it's a really neat symbiosis that exists.
I understand that there's a lot more creatures in the soil or organisms in the soil than that. Can you tell me about another, for instance, organism that we might find in the soil?
Yeah, there's like Cam said, there's a whole world down there. The soils host a quarter of the world's biodiversity. So there's tons of different types of organisms there. And so mostly the bacteria and the fungi are the smallest organisms, but there's many organisms that feed off of bacteria and feed off of fungi that are really critical, play a really critical role in what we call the soil food web. So they are feeding off of each other. So for example, one would be springtails or calendula, and they are little microfauna that eat mostly plant material. And so they're also really, really important in this carbon sequestration or converting organic matter into nutrients that are available for plants.
What is the most important way that we can help support these microbial populations in the soil?
Yeah, so that's exactly it. I think the microbes are there and you just have to nurture them. And so that's why, unless you have a problem soil that doesn't have a lot of microbes for some reason, you can probably just use techniques to nurture your own microbes. And those microbes are already adapted to your system. And so that's probably the best way to get a healthy microbial population. And what we're looking for and what we mean by healthy is usually biodiverse. So you want a bunch of different kinds of organisms. And so the ways to do that is a lot of times adding diversity above ground. So if you have, so in agricultural systems, we say crop rotation or adding cover crops or a different type of plant. So it's not just one monoculture. So if there's a way that you can add a cover crop or added some type of different plants into your system, each of those plants is going to feed a different microbe. And so you'll have different types of microbes there, and that's what you want. And also anything that puts organic matter and organic back into the soil. So keep your plant residues on the soil for as long as you can and get those nutrients mixing into the soil. Those are all good things. Minimizing tillage. Tillage is tricky for microorganisms because, like Cam said, you're usually turning over the soil, especially inversion of soil. If you can, you know, just if you need to till, if you can minimize like soil just being completely inverted, that's going to make a big difference in your microbial population.
And what about you, Cameron, with the work that you've been doing? Why do you feel that this is such an important thing to put a stress on?
Yeah, I think for me, it comes down to the fact that that soil is not dead. It's alive. It's very much alive. And so we can think about soil as another living organism, maybe even of itself. And that living organisms, there's a lot of things that they share in common. And so I think that really elevates the way that we think about soil and soil management, that it's not just a dead substrate that you're working with, but it's a living being, and we need to feed it in the same way that we are leaning on it to feed us.